Macmillan Audio presents A Certain Clarity, Selected Poems by Lawrence Joseph, read for you by the author. In memory of my mother, Clara Frances Joseph, and my father, Joseph Alexander Joseph. From Shouting at No One, 1983. I was appointed the poet of heaven. It was my duty to describe Teresa's small roses as they bent in the wind. I tired of this and asked you to let me write about something else. You ordered, sit in the trees where the angels sleep and copy their breaths in verse. So I did, and soon I had a public following. St. Agnes with red cheeks, St. Dorothy with a moon between her fingers, and the hosts of heaven. You said you failed me. I told you I'll write lovelier poems, but you answered you've already had your chance. You will be pulled from a womb into a city. Then, Joseph breathed slower, as if that would stop the pain splitting his heart. He turned the ignition key to start the motor and leave Joseph's food market to those who wanted what was left. Take the canned peaches, take the greens, the turnips, drink the damn whiskey spilled on the floor, he might have said. The fire was eating half Detroit. Joseph could only think of how his father, with his bad legs, used to hunch over the cutting board, alone and light particled with sawdust behind the meat counter, and he began to cry. Had you been there, you would have been thinking of the old market's wooden walls turned to ash, or how Joseph's whole arm had been shaking as he stooped to pick up an onion, and you would have been afraid. You wouldn't have known that soon Joseph would stumble, his body paralyzed an instant from neck to groin. You would simply have shaken your head at the tenement named Barbara in flames, or the guardsman with an M16 looking in the window of Dave's Playboy barbershop, then closed your eyes and murmured, "This can't be." You wouldn't have known it would take 9 years before you'd realize the voice howling in you was born then. It will rain all day. Breakfast at Buck's Eat Place. A portrait of Henry Ford, two eggs, hash browns, sour coffee. Afterwards, I walk out on Verner Avenue. Looks like a river in the rain. The signs from small stores hanging over the wet sidewalks like trees. But rivers are not passed over by a woman wearing a windbreaker with flags sewn on both shoulders, muttering to herself, head down, or an unshaven man older than he is, his body slanting as if he's about to fall headlong into a dream. Neither looks at me waiting at the light in my car as windshield wipers eliminate the stars of water. Along the cemetery, poplars look upward with thousands of eyes into the rain that comes down on the hills of lime and coal, reminding me of Metz. But the wind that lifted rhododendrons that April isn't here with me. What do I want driving through streets past bars where 50-year-old truck drivers sip whiskey and don't feel like talking, past houses where chimney smoke reveals fires in rooms I will never know? On Ford Street, I pass the bar with Fight Poverty, Drink and Dance, scrawled in white paint across its windowless front, and then a block-long building, windows knocked in, wires ripped from the walls, toilet bowls covered with dirt and spiderwebs. It will rain all day. I see a large crane lifting a railroad car, piles of bald tires, the two towers of St. Anne's, where in a corner there are crutches, body braces, and letters written to acknowledge miracles. I want all this to come to an end or a beginning. I want to look into the black eyes of the lone woman waiting for a bus and say something. I want my memory to hold this air so I can make the hills with white hair and the clouds breaking into blackness my own. Carry them with me like the letters and icons immigrants take in suitcases to strange countries. Not yet. When my father breathed unevenly, I, a child, breathed unevenly. I prayed in St. Marin, Maronite Catholic Church, for the world to change. When I saw my father's tears, I did not pray. I hated our market where the bullet missed his heart. I hoped the mists exhaled by the veil of Esk in a country of lakes 4,000 miles away would be mine. That was before Lopez whispered through his rotten teeth behind a maze of welding guns, "You're colored like me." Before I knew so much anger, so much need to avenge the Holy Cross and the Holy Card with its prayers for the dead, so many words I have no choice to say. Years without enough to make me stop talking, I want it all. I don't want the angel inside me, sword in hand, to be silent. Not yet. Fog. All day the air was fog. Couldn't see the barbed wire, rusting scraps, stacks and stacks of pallets, the tar paper roof of Dreamer's Shack, the underground caverns of salt hardening around bones. The fog says, "Who will save Detroit now?" A toothless face in a window shakes no. Sore fingers that want to be still say, "Not me." Not far away from where Yumna lies, freezing in bed, rolling her eyes, declaring, "This is a place. The remains of mountains wait to be moved through smokestacks into air." There is a God who hates us so much. 1. I was pulled from the womb into this city. I learned words when my grandfather lost both legs. Before the altar of God, I spent hours on my knees. I felt God's anger when my semen spilled into my hand. I ate God's body. I promised to never sin. I learned sadness from my mother's eyes. I learned silence in the dust a woman hid behind to cover her face of scars. I learned blood from my father fallen to a wooden floor, a thief's bullet inside him. He lived to warn me to forget. After that, I sucked darkness. 2. Years were a breath. Alone with whirring metal, clattering and pounding, I could not abstract smells that tortured me. I felt my words close inside me like marrow. I was a system of laws I hated. A boy afraid of burning in a city that was burning as my father cried and my mother whispered in my hair. 3. I am the poet of my city. I am the earth that burns the air, those who talk to themselves, blood and grease on hands. I need to know why I do not want to remember. In dreams, I run through streets terrified, away from mouths that hate me, my face washed with fear. In dreams, I kill so I will not be killed. The city is the shadow strapped to my back. I am the poet of that shadow. 4. Mother says, "Don't think about it too much." Father splashes cold water on his face, vomits his nightmare. He sweat before a man who wanted to kill him. I hold a holy candle and a palm branch, kiss the feet of a statue, drink holy water, imagine my body without words, pray to be able to sacrifice like the saint with arrows in his heart. God gives the world the brown and black frost the city climbs through to stars no one can see. 5. That is where I am now in this city, where there are hours of sun above the horizon and dirt in the air that makes me want to holler. There is a God who hates us so much. We are given ears to hear ribs kicked in. We are given eyes to see eyes close before a city that burns itself to death. Father shouts until his throat cracks. The river stops in its sludge. I pray to know what to pray for. There is a God who hates us so much. I was born in this city and live in this city and know this city like no one else. Who makes me eat my words and makes my eyes pain. I measure you according to your creation. In the 10th year of war, I bend over the machine. Heat and oil tune my inner ear. I'm not ashamed. I hang my head in anticipation. Father, steel smooth and silver, make my brain new. Jesus, the dirt on the walls is coming from my body. And love, the spirit coming from your body. Everywhere you look now, everything you touch, it's good. When, in the 10th year of war, I prayed for help and no one came, I danced before the machine. When you've been here long enough, you breathe yellow smoke, you breathe lead beside the river, talking out loud to no one. A rat slips by you into the cold green water. No longer at 6 o'clock mass do you kneel, body bent over and swaying, chanting, mea culpa, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa, offering your sorrow to the poor souls in purgatory. No longer do you dream of your mother as a child, waiting for a streetcar in the snow, praying to St. Jude to cure her sister's paralyzed hand. When the waitress argues what you do is hang them downtown in Grand Circus Park, that would keep them off the streets, you don't answer. You hear about the woman who 25 years ago touched the back of your head and said it's shaped just like your daddy's. She just sat there and watched blood spray from her cut wrist all over her room in the La Moon Manor Hotel. You just shake your head. You're not surprised, because when you've been here long enough, no one can make you believe the Black Cat dream book provides your winning number. Heaven answers your prayers with dust and you swallow it. Alone, early morning, on the Wyoming crosstown bus, you feel the need to destroy. Like everyone else, as the doors open and no one comes on. Do what you can. In the Church of I Am, she hears there's a time to heal, but her son, top dog of the Errol Flynn gang, doesn't lay down his sawed-off shotgun. The corn she planted in the field where the Marvel motor car factory once was doesn't grow with pigweed and cockle burr. When someone in the resurrection lounge laughs, Bohunk put the 2-foot dogfish in the whore's hand. Someone's daughter whispers, fuck you, places a half-smoked cigarette in her coat pocket, swings open the thick wooden door, and walks into air that freezes when it hears frost coming from Sault Ste. Marie. Driving, I see a shed of homing pigeons. Get out of my car to look. I answer what you care to a woman who shouts what you want. Beside the Church of St. John Nepomucene, an old man hunched in cold prays Mother of God to a statue of the Virgin Mary surrounded by a heart-shaped rosary of 53 black and 6 white bowling balls. Where the Ford and Chrysler freeways cross, a sign snaps 5,142,250, the number of cars produced so far this year in America. Not far away, on Beaufay Street, a crowd gathers to look at the steam from blood spread on the ice. The light red, I press the accelerator to keep the motor warm. I wonder if they know that after the jury is instructed on the burden of persuasion and the burden of truth, that after the sentence of 20 to 30 years comes down, when the accused begs, "Lord, I can't do that kind of time," the judge, looking down, will smile and say, "Then do what you can." It's not me shouting at no one. Before dawn, on the street again, beneath sky that washes me with ice, smoke, metal. I don't want to think the bullet pierced my shoulder, the junkie's rotten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.